Greetings from Paris and good morning to the Latin American speakers. Good evening to the Asians. Here in France is a day of Ascension, so it's a vacation day, but with much pleasure I can contribute to this very interesting webinar. I had the chance to become involved and very familiar with the guiding principles of urban and rural linkages that Remy mentioned before at the OECD. We've also been working a lot with some principles. We developed some principles on urban policy, some principles on rural policy, and we have one principle that combines both of them that addresses this notion of linkages, sort of say. What I will try to do today is to break down my presentation into two parts. One is to show you some analysis we have done, and actually this analysis is still not public, so you will be one of the early birds to see it, that we make use of a new definition that can give us some interesting insights about urban and rural linkages. And this analysis was done during the global financial crisis, or during the shock of 2008 until a couple of years ago. So there's some interesting insights on the effects of this crisis and the implications that it might have right now with the current COVID-19 crisis. And then my second part, I'll try to talk about some of the initiatives that we're seeing are being put in place to address the effects of the crisis with important implications on the topic of urban and rural. So just to start off, the new definition that we have used is based on the concept of functionality. And at the OECD, we've developed a global definition of what we call functional urban areas. These are the big cities and the areas of influence. And then the problem that we have is that outside of these functional urban areas, we have territories. The linkages between these two is difficult to capture when we just look at the functional urban area. So what we did is we try to merge both concepts and we develop a definition that essentially classifies all the territories across the OECD according to five categories. So the first one is, if you have more than half of the population living in metropolitan areas, that we divide these into what we call large cities and very large cities and large cities, very large meaning above 1 million. Large is about 250,000. And then if about less than half, 50% of the population doesn't live in these functional urban areas, we use a second criteria, which is based on accessibility. So if you're close to a big city, you're classified as this type of region. If you're close to a medium-sized city, you're classified according to this classification, and then we have the remote areas. And this allows us to disentangle the what we call the urban and rural linkages between places that are close to a big city and places that are close to like a medium-sized city. That's the interesting part of about this analysis. When we look at the distribution across the OECD, we have about 42% of the population live in large cities, 29 regions within inside of a functional urban area city. Then about 12% of territories near a large city, about 9% near territories of a small city, and then about 8% of remote. And what's interesting is that when we look at the degree of rurality, we find these three categories have different degrees of rurality. So the concept of urban and rural linkages is really associated to these three regions, whether you're connected to a big city, you have a high degree of rurality, but also if you're connected to a medium and intermediate city, you also have a high degree of rurality. And only the large metro regions and the remote places, you find a bit of this dichotomy. So looking at the population trends, we see that there's a population growth in the categories that have these part of this metropolitan regions. In all OECD countries, they've gained population in these types of regions, and only one country has gained in the non-metropolitan types of regions. And then we see that when we compare the regions that are close to a large city, they face much less population declines than what we find with a region that is close to a medium-sized region and a remote. For example, in the remote, about one-fourth of the countries are losing population. And the same is true with the regions that are close to a medium-sized city. So from the start, we see very different population dynamics between the two types of regions close to the cities between the large and the medium size. And if we do dig a little bit deeper, we see that aging is a challenge across the non-metropolitan regions, in particular the remote places. But we do, what's interesting is that we find much higher net migration rates in those territories close to the large cities and the large ones, as opposed to the remote regions and the regions near a medium-sized city. So you do see the effects of these large regions in attracting people, not just to the functional urban areas themselves, but also to the places adjacent to them. Now, if we look at the effects of the crisis, we find that before the crisis, the remote regions and the regions close to the medium-sized cities were converging. They were growing much, much faster than the large cities. But the effects of the crisis, which is the bubble, the filled-up places, they've fallen all the way down with much lower growth rates. So the bubbles below is the growth rates from 2008 to 2017. And the ones that are on the top are from before the crisis. So you do find the crisis had a big effect on these remote places and the regions close to intermediate and small cities. The big cities, they become much more resilient to the crisis, and also the rural close to the big cities. So we do find that recovery is associated with large cities, you know, not just the cities themselves, but also the territories that are close to them. So some takeaways about this current crisis, we are expected that the larger cities, right now everybody is suffering, but we do expect that they will bounce back quicker. And it's the territories that are more vulnerable and close to the intermediate cities that will have a bigger effect as the crisis unfolds to them. We also know that some of these low density areas, they have less access to medical services, testing facilities, and medical equipment. They also have a higher share of population at risk, that means elderly, and they have less access to digital infrastructures. Something that is very interesting across the OECD that we're asking ourselves, what we've seen is that many people have left the big cities towards more low densely populated areas. And we call this sort of like an urban penalty to try to induce self-isolation. So the question that we have is some of these new norms that they call that is more remote distributive work, you know, be able to telework more often, get access to some of these services in remote ways. Will that really change the demographic patterns and also the linkages between urban and rural? We expect it will, and we expect that these linkages will be strengthened. They will become much stronger. Then what we also find is that perhaps some of these medium and small cities can really benefit from some of the better services. We expect many countries to start investing in some of these digital technologies. So we do think that this can be very, very beneficial to some of these intermediate and medium-sized cities. We've also seen there's a strengthening of these local networks and cooperative structures in some of these remote areas. So this is also quite interesting too, that is evolving of how some of these civic society has come together during the COVID-19 crisis and in order to face not this shock, but in terms of the future shocks. So in terms of what we're doing at the OECD, we've been producing a number of these policy notes. We produce one on SMEs, one on cities, one on tourism. And we're about to release a policy note on what are the responses from the rural side, which have strong implications with the urban and rural linkages. And what we have seen is that there's about four types of actions across the OECD. One, countries are already investing in what they call digital infrastructure and improving the accessibility in rural areas. From Korea and Poland, they're putting in place special loan guarantee systems to better promote or better connect some of these remote places to make sure that also some of these areas enjoy from the digital infrastructure. Second, we've seen a lot of initiatives to maintain basic services in some of these remote areas. So it's keeping up the electricity bills, you know, the water sanitation, food aid, all these kinds of things. Third, we've seen some actions that are trying to support rural businesses and workers, anything around SMEs, anything around tourism, mining. So there's a number of interesting measures that have been put in place. Then there's been a lot of initiatives trying to help mobilize local networkers and healthcare providers, network of doctors going to some of these smaller towns and trying to also provide access of medical equipment to some of these areas. And then what we think is that these are five broad areas of policy that we think the crisis can provide to some of these medium-sized cities. The first one is the speed up of digital infrastructure. We think that countries are going to really jump on these digital bandwagon. And here we're not just talking about just putting fiber optic cables or broadbands, but also supporting the ecosystem, you know, training people how to use some of these digital solutions and how to deliver services. We expect also a lot of initiatives to encourage the uptake of remote services. And here we're also talking about provision of public services, for example, e-services to do your paperwork and governments. We've seen a lot of examples where some of these remote places are enjoying better access to a lot of these paperwork through remote measures. I mentioned before the support of the community-based and social innovation projects are emerging. This is something quite interesting. We also think that it's important not to forget the sustainability agenda. So we might face a danger that a lot of governments are trying to address the effects of COVID-19 and putting aside the transition to a low carbon economy that is very, very critical to keep on enhancing. And then we also expect a number of policies looking at how to make some of these smaller places more resilient against future shocks. So these are just some insights that I just wanted to share with you of what the thinking is within our group here at the OECD. Thank you.